Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Angela Constance on Scotland's prison population. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary, around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In my previous statement to Parliament in May, I set out the challenge we face in addressing the prison population and the need for immediate and continued action. The difficult but necessary step of emergency release over the summer had an immediate impact. The population reduced from 8,270 to just below 7,900, and the risk to the safe operation of our prisons was temporarily averted. As I highlighted in May, the impact was expected to be temporary, and that has proven to be the case. The population has continued to rise and once again reached critical levels. As of this morning, there are 8,322 people in our custody, 27% of whom are on remand. And it is not just about numbers, it is also about the complex needs of the population and the persistent pressures on prison staff. I remain grateful to the Scottish Prison Service staff for their continued resilience. I have seen firsthand their excellent work to maintain positive relationships in prisons and their ability to find solutions. The latest projections through to January 2025 indicate that the prison population will likely continue to rise. Without intervention, this would take us into an unsustainable position, and we cannot and must not allow this to transpire. Over the last decade, the average length of prison sentences has increased, while there has been a consistently high remand population. There is no single lever to address this ongoing rise, and that is why we must continue to pursue a wide range of actions. Since my last statement, the implementation of the Children Care and Justice Act and the transfer of all under-18s to secure care has freed up additional capacity at HMP Polmont. In addition, the Scottish Prison Service continues to maximise all available remaining capacity across the estate. Despite these efforts, these are actions which will only provide very short-term relief if population trends continue. There is also a continued focus on optimising the use of home detention curfew. Numbers were reduced by emergency early release and are now rising again, currently at around 107. I can confirm plans to lay regulations later this year to enable GPS technology to be used to monitor individuals being released on home detention curfew. Subject to parliamentary approval, these regulations would come into force in January. We also have high levels of use of electronic monitoring. Over 2,100 people are being monitored on any given day, with electronically monitored bail now available in every local authority area. We are also increasing our investment to address this significant challenge. In addition to the 10% uplift in the Prison Service resource budget, we increased our funding to community justice by £14 million this year to further strengthen alternatives to custody. Building that capacity takes time, but recent statistics show a marked and sustained increase in the use of diversion from prosecution, structured deferred sentences and bail supervision. These actions are having an impact and have reduced the growing population from where it would be without them. However, it is evident that further action is necessary across the justice system. The independent functions and decision-making across the justice system will always be fully respected. However, it is vital that partners collaborate to ensure the system works effectively and in the shared understanding of the critical risk that an increasing prison population poses to the entire justice system. The Lord Advocate will update Parliament after this statement in her role as the independent head of the systems of criminal prosecution and the investigation of deaths. And I am grateful to the Lord Advocate for her leadership and engagement on this important issue. Presiding Officer, in my last statement to Parliament, I set out our intention to look at how we manage the release of long-term prisoners and to consult on proposals for legislative change. The response to our consultation, which sought views on bringing forward the point at which most long-term prisoners are released automatically, were thoughtful and constructive, and analysis has been published today. There was notable support for increasing the time some long-term prisoners spend in the community under supervision as part of their sentence, and recognition of the benefits that this can bring. However, there were also concerns that changing the long-term prisoner release point at pace would present significant practical difficulties. Given the need for any changes to take effect quickly, this prompted an exploration of alternative approaches. And I noted with interest the proposals put forward by the Institute for Government in July. Those proposals included the option to change the release point for certain prisoners from the halfway point to either 45% or 40% of the sentence. And of course, the UK government has recently implemented the latter with a reported 1,700 prisoners released in September, with more to come. While our justice systems are not the same, I intend to pursue a similar policy to change the point at which most short-term prisoners are released from the current 50% to after 40% of their sentence has been served. This proposal would come with statutory exclusions in relation to domestic abuse and sexual offences, recognising the particular concerns which will arise in relation to such offences. This will require primary legislation, which I plan to introduce in November, and will ask Parliament's permission to progress on an emergency basis. I remain committed to considering changes to the long-term prisoner release point and will seek subordinate legislation making powers in the bill to allow us to return to this. The immediate focus of the bill, however, will be on changing the release point for short-term prisoners. Short-term prisoners are those sentenced to less than 4 years in prison and are generally not subject to supervision on release. This approach would therefore result in relatively small changes to release dates, as well as avoiding some of the complexities it highlighted in the consultation. My intention is that any changes of release point would apply to those already in custody to allow for both an immediate and sustained impact on the prison population. We estimate that the new release point, after being implemented, could result in the population being between 260 and 390 lower than it would be without any change. This will not resolve the prison population by itself, but importantly, it is sustainable action rather than a temporary measure. I recognise very much the concerns that arise from victims and their families, and I am committed to working closely with victim support organisations. Public safety remains paramount, which is why I am focusing on short-term prisoners only and with built-in exemptions. Whilst the priority is upon actions that can deliver a sustained reduction to the prison population, it is vital that plans are in place should the prison population reach the point where more immediate action is needed. It is not my intention to ask Parliament to authorise the use of emergency early release again at this stage. However, I am aware that if it is necessary and there is no alternative, it may be needed. We will therefore begin contingency planning on this option, working with key delivery partners, including victim support organisations, learning from the emergency early release during the summer, and to make sure that plans are robust with a clear focus on public protection. Presiding Officer, I have outlined today vital steps we must take towards addressing the rise in prison population. I am, however, clear that further and deeper action will be needed. The challenges we face are complex, and there isn't a single or straightforward solution. Of course, we must continue to tackle crime, building on the fact that recorded crime is down almost 40% since 2006-07. We must continue to strengthen community justice. Community-based interventions and services help ensure that justice is done and can be more effective in reducing re-offending and assisting with rehabilitation than short-term custodial sentences. The safety and well-being of SPS staff and those in their care must also remain at the forefront of our actions to ensure that prisons continue to function effectively. And we must ensure that we have a prison estate which houses those who pose the risk, the greatest risk to the public, and provides the full range of support needed for people to leave on a better path and never to turn back. This will require a collective response but it is necessary to deliver what we all want to see: less crime, fewer victims and safer communities. Thank you.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business, and encourage members wishing to ask a question who haven't already done so to press their request to speak buttons. I call first Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I was last in this brief, between 2017 and 21, I recall frequently discussing the ballooning prison population and what to do about it, yet today it is at record highs. And as the Cabinet Secretary concedes, it is projected to continue to rise. Now, what strikes me coming back is that despite promises several years ago, there is still no long-term holistic strategy and route map to address the prison system within the principles of justice and due regard for victims that will avoid panicked measures from this government. I find it extraordinary that 17 years of SNP Justice Secretaries have failed to strategise a proper plan. So will the Cabinet Secretary confirm that one will be published this side of the 2026 election or not? Now, secondly, in 2015, Nicola Sturgeon announced the end of automatic early release, saying doing so represented the Scottish Government delivering on our justice commitments. This Cabinet Secretary proposes to reintroduce it, although deals with the short-term prisoners and doesn't even account for the release point for long-term prisoners, undermining our justice system, undermining sentencing and throwing victims under a bus. Does the Cabinet Secretary concede she is abandoning her justice commitments in favour of a panicked response to this government's long-term failures? And finally, on those victims, given that only 2% were notified during the last panicked response to overcrowding by this government, what figure of victim notification would represent success when this scheme comes into play?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I start by welcoming Liam Kerr to his new role? I look forward to working with him in a constructive and in a serious and considered manner. He's never worked with me before, but I can assure him I have little appetite for posturing, pedantry or ideologically narratives that deny the rationale of following the evidence about what will work at the end of the day to make our communities safer. And can I also say to Mr Kerr that working at pace is not the same as being panicked. I have made several statements to this Parliament. I am more than happy to share those with Mr Kerr so that he can get up to brief in returning to his justice portfolio. But over the course of that time, I have outlined a range of short-term, medium-term and longer-term measures. He will, of course, recall that his previous UK Conservative government, in a somewhat secretive fashion, have released 10,000 prisoners between October 2023 and July this year. I, however, have been utterly upfront because it is not in my DNA to be panicked, but I'm also a Cabinet Secretary for Justice that is absolutely determined to see this through, to reform our justice system. And yes, that means reforming our prison system, but we have to remember that reforming our prison system is absolutely essential if we are going to reach our ambitions to put victims at the very heart of our system. The consultation itself in terms of long-term prisoners made very clear that there is rationale for community safety, for people to spend longer under robust community sentencing. And I will, of course, if Mr Kerr wishes and is helpful, provide an overview of all our plans in this area.
Katie Clark.
We welcome the announcement of regulations to enable GPS technology for home detention curfew, but regulations have been in place for a number of years to allow GPS, for example, where an accused is on bail, and the GPS systems are still not in place to enable that to happen. So can the Cabinet Secretary say whether she has now given instructions for the private company to carry out the work needed for GPS to be used, as we've been calling for some time? We also welcome the extra £14 million for community justice, but the Criminal Justice Committee was told yesterday that this only covers inflation. We now know that only five victims were informed in the 477 releases over the summer, and the reoffender rate was 12%. When the Cabinet Secretary announced the early release scheme, I asked that she exclude violent offenders, given the lack of appropriate systems of support and planning, the lack of victim notification, and the higher risk of this particular group of prisoners. What lessons has the Cabinet Secretary learned, and what consideration is she giving to prioritising offenders who have been convicted of non-violent
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much welcome Ms Clark's support and endorsement for the use of home detention curfew. We have made considerable progress in the planning work that is necessary for that, and are engaging closely with the contractual company who will deliver the technology of that. There are, of course, operational aspects for that for the Scottish Prison Service, and as Ms Clark is aware that there are particular advantages to GPS, we want to learn some of the lessons from south of the border. For example, we won't be tethering people to the wall so they can charge their tag, would be one vital lesson. But there is considerable value in piloting GPS in the context of home detention curfew before rolling it out to other facilities and other modes of supervision. I should also say that our use of electronic monitoring continues to increase. It is around over 2,000 across all orders. Now, in terms of the very important point, which I have to be fair, Mr Kerr also raised in terms of victim notification, let me make clear that I will work closely with victims and victim support organisations over the prisoners' bill. We must ensure that our justice system and including of the use of imprisonment delivers first and foremost for victims of crime, as well as the rehabilitation to prevent further harm, which of course is in the interests of victims. I share the member's disappointment that the numbers who were notified formally through the VNS scheme was low, and I remain committed to increasing awareness around the current scheme, doing everything that I can in partnership with VSOs to increase that registration, and also to draw Parliament's attention to that the Minister for Victim Safety yesterday published a response to how we can make important improvements to victims' notification schemes, and we will use the Victims, Witness and Justice Reform Bill as a vehicle to do that.
Thank you. I've got 10 colleagues wishing to ask a question. We've now got less than 30 minutes. The questions will need to be briefer, but so will the responses, Cabinet Secretary. I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The numbers to be released early under the proposals outlined is relatively small compared to the overall population. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if she's confident that this can make a long-term difference?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, this is something that I have wrestled with. It was important to consider this measure in the round with other measures. I am confident that the numbers are high enough to make a difference. The anticipated reduction is 260 to 390, but it's not a step that must be taken on its own. But it is a significant enough step in its own right, but it must be combined with other actions as well. The number could have been higher, but I have taken the decision that in terms of the legislation that I will bring forward to Parliament to have statutory exclusions for those who are serving sentences for domestic abuse and sexual offences. I hope that that is the right balance.
Sharon Dowie to be followed by Ben McFair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP Government have so far failed to get to grips with the rising and overwhelming prison population. Meanwhile, community justice, which would see offenders dealt with without putting further pressure in prisons, is also being failed by the SNP. Justice social work needs more funding and more resources to deal with work demands and increasingly complex caseloads, but the Government's spending priorities are not fully in line with their announced objectives. If the Scottish Government are serious about using community sentencing to alleviate pressure on the prison population, can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the required funding will be directed towards it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I look forward to Ms Dowie's amendments as we go through the budget support process. I look forward to Ms Dowie continuing to advocate for additional resources for our prison estate and for criminal justice social work. I'm very proud that it was this form of criminal justice social work that delivered a substantial increase to resources available to our community justice services. I'm also very proud to see that recent statistics show that we have an increase in the number of community criminal justice social workers. It's unfortunate that Ms Dowie doesn't remember the austerity and the harm inflicted by her government, not least in terms of capital budgets. But I'm glad that she's repented, and I look forward to her full support during the budget process.
Ben McPherson to be followed by Polly McNeill.
Can the Cabinet Secretary say more about how the Scottish Government will ensure that victims and organisations representing victims are consulted on the proposed legislation, and how victims and their families will be informed about the release of prisoners if and when that happens regarding their particular case?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I know that changes to release processes can be really upsetting for victims and distressing, and that clear and accurate information is absolutely essential so that victims understand if and how the prisoner in their case may be impacted. And I will work closely with victim support organisations to ensure that clear information is available to them, and will continue to do so when the legislation is introduced and subject to agreement by Parliament ahead of any changes being made. And information is also, I'm pleased to say, available through the Scottish Government website, which sets out my proposals and the rights that victims have to access information about their case.
Polly McNeill to be followed by Claire Hawley.
So, Cabinet Secretary, you have announced a substantial change in prison policy on the release of short-term prisoners, 40% into their sentence. I'm sure you will agree it will be concerning for victims unless this is addressed by the government's investment in reoffending rates. Now, 57 out of the 477 prisoners that were early released were back in jail. So what can the Cabinet Secretary say about what further investment is going to be made to ensure that this policy is not going to result in further reoffending cycles?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it's important to recognise that generally and globally, reconviction rates in Scotland are amongst the lowest that they've been. I do, of course, accept that no level of reoffending is acceptable in any shape or form. The return rate from the early emergency release that was undertaken over the summer was 12%. That, of course, is significantly lower than comparable rates when you look at short-term prisoners who are returned to custody. So it is an important issue. Of course, investment in the Scottish Government public services overall and in justice will in large part very much depend on the Chancellor of Exchequer's forthcoming statements. But again, I look forward to cross-party support for a justice budget in the weeks and months to come.
Claire Hawley to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
The levels of remand at around a quarter of the prison population seems to be at an unacceptable level. Will the Cabinet Secretary expand on what steps have been taken to improve alternatives to custody for those who are waiting to go to court?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very much agree that the remand population is too high, and I actually believe there's a consensus of that opinion across this chamber. As I said in my statement, 27% of the prison population is a remand population. That equates to 2,247. The consistent provision of alternatives to remand is absolutely critical, and we are working hard with partners to increase the availability, consistency and effectiveness of alternatives to remand. Bail supervision is available in every local authority. We're seeing good investment in bail supervision and also in electronic monitoring, and we'll build on that as we go forward with the new third sector contract and through care.
Maggie Chapman to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. I've raised before the important issue of post-release support for people, given the heightened risk of death by suicide and substance misuse following release. Is the Cabinet Secretary of the view that community justice, mental health services and broader community support organisations have sufficient skilled staff and resources required to ensure that, with the earlier release point for short-term prisoners, they can properly support those on release and the communities that receive them?
Secretary.
Ms Chapman is quite correct to raise the risks of any period of transition for any individual. And for those of us who've lost a client due to suicide or drug death, we know the impact that that has, not least on their families. It is imperative, as you will know, that long-term prisoners are all subject to statutory supervision, but in terms of those released from short-term periods of custody, there is voluntary aftercare that is available, and it also speaks to the importance of third sector support, and that's why we are launching next year a new third sector contract for through care services.
Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her statement. In that statement, it was said that the average length of prison sentences have increased by 32%. Mm-hmm. Are these all for long-term sentences, or has there been an increase in short-term sentences, including under 1 year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, what we have actually established is that there is an increase and the length of sentences pretty much across all sentenced prisoner groups. And that is not the only pressure, but it's one of the reasons that the population is increasing. We, despite introducing the presumption against short sentences, an action that has been emulated south of the border more recently, while that has seen a reduction in the proportion of sentences issued of under a year, the proportion of those sentences issued that are under a year still remain high. So we still have hearts and minds to win in terms of where the evidence takes us, and the evidence takes us that alternatives to custody reduce the risk of reoffending.
Willie Rennie, to be followed by Maurice Golden.
I agree with that, and as a Liberal I believe alternatives to prison are far more effective, not just because the prisons are full, but we've had a series of short-term emergency measures by necessity. The Cabinet Secretary refers to further longer-term measures. Can she set out what those measures are and by when they will be implemented?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I start by reassuring Mr Rennie that I'm in this for the long haul. I will see prison reform through, not just, although this is vitally important, for the sake of those in our care and those frontline staff who diligently put themselves on the front line for us, because I fundamentally believe that reform of our prison service is necessary in terms of achieving and maintaining even safer communities. Safer communities and supporting victims is not mutually exclusive from a well-functioning, effective, efficient and effective prison service. And I will see that through, and I look forward to the challenge that Mr Rennie no doubt will give this government. We have platforms of reform to build on, whether it's presumption against short-term sentences, the work around community payback orders, the work we're doing in terms of electronic monitoring, the work that we've done in terms of bail and release, and also the Children's Care and Justice Bill, which I'm pleased to say that Mr Rennie and the Liberals supported bail and release and the Children's Care and Justice Bill, unlike some others in this chamber.
Thank you. We've got two colleagues still to go. We'll get them both in if the questions and the responses are brief. Maurice Golden, be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I appreciate there is a limited deployment of millennium-era technology to monitor individuals in the community. But what consideration has been given to the use of artificial intelligence to both monitor location, but also health, well-being, mental health and support, learning and skills?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think that is a very good point raised by Mr Golden, because there are technological solutions not just to the supervision of offenders, but also that can be used in terms of access to learning. And indeed some of the reforms that have taken place within the prison system. Dare I mention in-cell telephony, which in time could be used to facilitate more by way of digital learning and digital support for prisoners.
And Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's clear that longer-term measures and thinking is needed to tackle why we have such a high prison population compared to many other countries. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe that the penal review that she is going to establish will be able to recommend changes that Parliament can agree to?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, Presiding Officer, I am very hopeful of that. I agree about the importance of long-term strategic thinking on this issue. And as all, having the courage of our convictions and the courage to follow the evidence about what works, what will actually make our community safer at the end of the day, and that is evidence-led policies and interventions and not politically inspired rhetoric. The independent review of sentencing and penal policy will provide a further opportunity to not repeat but build on the previous commissions, and in particular look at those existing barriers that currently are in our way in terms of motoring on with reform, not just of our prison system but also of our wider criminal justice system, all of which is crucial if we are to achieve our ambitions of putting victims at the very heart of our justice system.
Thank you. That concludes the statement. There will be a brief pause to allow front benches to change before we move to the next item of business.